Okay, good afternoon. We're going to get started. My name is Kenji Yoshino, and I'm the Chief Justice Earl Warren Professor of Constitutional Law here at the Law School. And today I feel that we are doubly fortunate. First, we get to discuss the Don't Ask, Don't Tell policy at a time when this issue is breaking. It's not a coincidence that this panel occurs when the military recruiters have come today to recruit on our campus. Outlaw, which is a co-sponsor of this forum, planned this forum to occur on this date. However, it is serendipitous that, as Dean Revez mentioned in his community-wide email today, that this is the first day in which, under Pentagon guidelines publicized yesterday, our openly gay students can apply to serve their country in the military without being discriminated against with regard to their sexual orientation. So, this is indeed a historic day. Of course, we do not know how long the status quo will last. In fact, this morning, the Justice Department filed an emergency stay request with the Ninth Circuit. But I nonetheless feel that this is an extraordinary day for the law school and for the nation, and hopefully a harbinger of things to come, in case my own priors on this issue are not apparent already. The second reason I feel extraordinarily fortunate is that we get to discuss the policy with an extremely distinguished and knowledgeable group of panelists. A theme I would like to explore, although I don't want us to feel tethered to it, is the increasing role that Republicans are playing in the movement for LGBT rights. So to put this in its most provocative terms, the Don't Ask, Don't Tell policy was created by a Democratic president and is now being defended by a Democratic administration against a challenge brought successfully by a Republican LGBT group. Of course, that's not the full extent of the truth. That's not the only thing that's going on. For instance, the Senate positions on DADT break pretty starkly according to party lines. But nonetheless, we see in this litigation and also in the Perry versus Schwarzenegger same-sex marriage litigation, an increasing coalition being built between Democrats and Republicans on this issue. So logistically, what I'd like to do is to divide our time between a very short period in which I will pose questions, really just a question or two to each of our panelists, and then open it to the floor so that this can be a true conversation. Before I do that, I would like to introduce our panelists. So starting with my right in the literal sense there, we have Clark Cooper, who is executive director of the Log Cabin Republicans, an organization that is dedicated to building an inclusive Republican Party and advocating for gay rights legislation. Clark is also executive director of Liberty Education Forum, a nonpartisan education foundation. Previously, he served in the George W. Bush administration as a diplomat, last serving as an alternative representative to the United Nations Security Council. He's also a combat veteran from the Iraq campaign and remains a captain in the Army Reserve. To my immediate right is Richard Socarides, who is an attorney and who was White House Special Assistant and Senior Advisor to President Bill Clinton, where he specialized in policy, legal, and political issues. He served as Chief Advisor to Clinton on gay civil rights from 1997 to 1999. He previously served on the board of Lambda Legal. Socarides, Richard, is frequently quoted in national publications and often appears as a commentator and expert on television. He's currently of counsel here in New York City to the law firm of Brady Klein Weissman. And finally, to my left, Aaron Tax is the Service Members Legal Defense Network's legal director. Prior to joining SLDN in 2006, Aaron was a Presidential Management Fellow at the Department of the Army, during which time he served as a Special Assistant United States Attorney, practiced labor law with the U.S. Army V Corps, Office of the Staff Judge Advocate in Heidelberg, Germany, where he wrote final agency decisions in employment discrimination cases. So I would like to thank all of our panelists for participating, and we'll now jump right in. So I'd actually like to begin with the genesis of this policy, which means that I am going to begin with you, Richard, if I may. So you were in the Clinton administration when this policy was being formulated. And so if you could just speak a little bit about how we move from the 1981 categorical exclusion of gays in the military under a executive order to a presidential campaign promise of President-elect Clinton that he would lift the ban on gays in the military, to the shuttle diplomacy that resulted in the kind of calcification of the policy as don't ask, don't tell, making it a legislative enactment than simply an executive one. If you could just describe your...
I can see you're really getting the easy stuff out of the way early.
Yes, exactly. So I'm going to try and ask tough questions.
You want a one-minute answer?
Of both sides. But if you could just explain your role and what that looked like from your point of vantage as a democratic LGBT rights strategist in a democratic administration, that would be a really useful place to start.
Right. Okay, well, thanks for having me. Thanks, everybody, for being here. You know, I think that the, let me just preface that by saying that I think that the, you know, the telling of recent history is always a very subjective exercise, especially if you participated in it on some level, and, you know, because we remember, right, we remember what we want to remember about it. So having prefaced it by saying that, and I'm also not a historian. I mean, there's been a terrific book by Nathaniel Frank called Conduct Unbecoming, who is the historian on this, and so. But from my subjective memory, what happened was in 1991, when Bill Clinton was first running for president, he was like a second-tier candidate for president, the governor of Arkansas. And he said that in his view, that gay people ought to be allowed to serve openly in the military under all circumstances with no exception. And, you know, to put that in a little bit historical context, this was 1991, as he was an early candidate. There was, you know, no country in the world allowed gay people to serve openly in the military in 1991. You know, this was before Ellen. You know, the most public gay person was Rock Hudson, and we only knew Rock Hudson was gay because he had died from AIDS. You could be denied a top security clearance in the government just because you were gay. And in fact, when I got my top security clearance in 1993 after President Clinton was elected, you know, that was an issue. I mean, they weren't really doing it, still doing it, but the law on the books, the rule on the books was you could be denied a job just because you were gay, because you were considered, you know, de facto a security, possible security risk. So in that environment, a guy running for president, governor of Arkansas, said gay people ought to be allowed to serve. He had also never served in the military. I think he was probably, as I'm remembering this correctly, the first president ever to be president who had not served in the military, and he was a draft dodger. So with that background, he took this position and won. And then right after he was elected, and it was a big, you know, it was kind of a big issue for the gay community. It's why the gay community supported him, and he was unequivocal about it. It was not a huge issue in the general election sense. But right after he was elected, on Veterans Day, which I think was like November 10th or 11th, in 1990.
It's always the 11th.
The 11th, 92, okay, a veteran would know that. It's your day. He was giving a speech to veterans, and he came off the podium, and a CBS News reporter asked him, well, what are you going to do about this promise to let gays serve in the military? And he said, well, I'm going to do it. I'm going to sign an executive order. And there was like this huge rebellion in the Pentagon, because no one believed that he would actually go through with it. And Colin Powell, who was the head of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, got together with Sam Nunn, who was the then Democratic chairman of the Senate Armed Services Committee, and decided that they would hold hearings essentially to demonstrate to the country that the military, that gay people shouldn't ought to be allowed to serve, that it was a national security risk. And they had these very kind of famous hearings in Washington. But what they did that was very clever is they actually held a Senate hearing on a submarine in the sleeping quarters where these guys sleep, you know, row by row in a submarine. And they went down there with a couple of news cameras, and Sam Nunn and they held a hearing in the sleeping quarters, and they had these guys, and they said, who here, you know, raise your hand if you favor the current policy. And, of course, all these guys on camera raised their hands. So they demonstrated in a very graphic way that this was not workable. The long and the short of it is that for the first couple of months that President Clinton was president, January, February, March, basically all the news was about the fact that he supported this policy that nobody in the military supported. So there was, around March, an effort to come up with any kind of compromise that would allow the president somehow to declare victory, but would also give the Pentagon what they wanted. And there was a compromise that was originally called Don't Ask, Don't Tell, Don't Pursue, was the original name of this. And Barney Frank said, oh, this is going to work. Barney Frank, who was the only out member of Congress in Washington, said, this is going to work because people are going to be allowed to serve. They're just not going to be able to say. It was a face-saving compromise. And, you know, at that point, people went to President Clinton and said, this is the best you are going to be able to do. And you ought to take it and get out of it, because if you don't, what we're going to end up with is a legislatively imposed complete ban. There had never been a legislatively imposed complete ban, as far as I know. And, you know, he took it. And going back to the beginning of this answer where I said you people remember about history what they want to remember, I mean, some of you may know that President Clinton, when he was recently asked about this, said, Colin Powell came to my office and said that you could serve under Don't Ask, Don't Tell, you could serve in the military and you know, have a partner that you lived with, go to a gay bar, march in a gay rights parade, so long as when you were on duty, you didn't, you know, you were somehow discreet about it. You know, that's all of us kind of remembering about this, what we want to remember about it. I mean, obviously there was a lot more to it. So it was a way to get out of it. Now, just let me just say one other thing, because a lot of people say to me, well, you know, you say to me personally, you know, you were there, so why are you such a critic of the current administration? Why are you so hard on them about not getting rid of this policy now? Why are you so hard on everybody about the need to do away with this and do away right away? I mean, weren't you there, as you said to me in a private conversation, he said to me, you were there at the scene of the crime. What are you complaining about? And the truth is, you know, I was there, and it was a different time. But I think most importantly is that, you know, I was able to witness up close the consequences of making a political decision rather than a decision on principle. And, you know, a lot has changed. My thinking has evolved. But as someone who witnesses the grave consequences of making that kind of a decision when you're dealing with something like this, I think it's important for me to speak out, so I have. But I realize that, you know, people have a valid point in that regard. I'm sorry I gave such a long-winded answer.
No, it's a terrific answer. Thank you. So just to fix ideas and to be really clear about what we're talking about, the Don't Ask, Don't Tell policy was preceded by an executive order that stated that homosexuality is incompatible with military service. So that was a 1981 order. So the 1993 Don't Ask, Don't Tell policy does really, to put it really too crudely, two things, right? One is to say that it makes something that was primarily a matter of pure executive discretion into a piece of legislation. So the Don't Tell portion of Don't Ask, Don't Tell is now embodied in a congressional enactment. And as Richard was saying, this is the first time that the word homosexuality, in fact, has been encoded in the U.S. code. It's kind of an irony, right, because the legislation that tells homosexuals to not speak out is actually the first time when Congress is actually speaking to the issue of sexual orientation directly. But the other thing that Don't Ask, Don't Tell does, and it depends on whether or not you see this as an advance or a retreat, right, depending on the baseline. But the reason that this is seen as a compromise at all over the earlier policy is that it replaced a policy of categorical exclusion with something that at least on its face said you are permitted to serve so long as you don't disclose that you are gay. So it shifted the ground for exclusion from status to conduct, right? And so the idea, the ostensible idea behind the policy was that we only punish people for homosexual conduct. And so the reason that we're kicking you out if you say that you are gay is not because we're burdening speech. That would be a First Amendment violation. We would never do that. What the military is saying is if you say that you are gay, that raises a rebuttable presumption that you've engaged in homosexual conduct. And if you fail to rebut that presumption, then you will be excluded for having engaged in sexual conduct. Right? Now, I want to say that, you know, on its face, that would seem to be an advance. But I want to turn now to Aaron, if I might, to think about the ways in which this has actually operated on the ground. And we can start with the idea that immediately after the Don't Ask, Don't Tell policy was implemented, exclusions from the military skyrocketed. Right? So we actually had more separations under Don't Ask, Don't Tell than we had on the previous, ostensibly more severe executive order. So Aaron, if you could just talk a little bit about how this policy works on the ground. You know, as Oliver Wendell Holmes once said, the life of the law is not logic, it's experience. So it's good to actually get somebody who is, you know, has that low on the ground experience as you do and as Clark does.
Sure. And we speak to service members every single day, and it's just not saying that they call every day. They actually do, asking us questions about the law and how it impacts their lives. So the first thing I would say about this movement from supposedly status to conduct is that it's really a fiction. And that's because you look at the way homosexual conduct is defined under the law, and it's really just being gay. And that's because it's one of three things. The first thing is a statement to anyone in your life ever that you're gay. So as I tell people, if you came out in nursery school, you know, who knows, but if you came out in nursery school, that nursery school teacher 18 years later can out you under Don't Ask, Don't Tell, and that's legit. So it includes statements before you even join the military. And again, it's not just like a hypothetical. People are actually outed on that basis. It includes statements to your parents. I know two people personally who've been outed by their parents. We spoke to one guy who was an ROTC, finally came out to his dad, who it turns out was a retiree from the military, who was not accepting of gays. Monday morning, he calls his ROTC instructor and outed him, and he got kicked out. So it's not just a hypothetical that this stuff could happen. It actually does happen. So again, that's the first category, is a statement to anyone in your life ever. Another big problem area for us in that category is Facebook. People are out on Facebook. They have pictures up on Facebook. That counts under Don't Ask, Don't Tell. So I think a lot of people think about the law, and they think it's don't come to work and tell people you're gay, or don't come to work and tell people about your sex life, and you'll just be fine. But in fact, it covers every aspect of your life. The second category is what the law terms homosexual acts, which is any touching of someone of the same sex for sexual gratification, whether it's hand-holding, hugging, close dancing, and obviously use your imagination beyond that. For example, we had two cases, I believe it was in the last year or two, of people investigated for hugging. So again, it's not that it's just about sex. I mean, it's any interaction whatsoever. We had another client who had a picture up in his locker at work, and his arm was on another guy's shoulder in this photograph, and he was investigated for that picture. As it turns out, it was his cousin. So they stopped the investigation. But again, it gives you an idea of what they're looking into when we talk about so-called homosexual acts. The third category is marriage or attempted marriage to someone of the same sex. So that would include civil unions or domestic partnerships. We had a client who was investigated because she had a domestic partnership in the city of Denver. And of course, now with marriage increasing across the country, we're having more and more cases where people are married and are concerned about the consequences of that. So those are really the three areas that fall under Don't Ask, Don't Tell, and they're all termed homosexual conduct. So in your mind, if you hear that someone's been kicked out of the military for homosexual conduct, you'll think about acts. But really, they might be kicked out for homosexual conduct because it said on Facebook, I identify as gay. That's homosexual conduct in the military. The other quick thing I'd want to address is you're thinking, well, what does Don't Ask, Don't Tell mean then? Where does that even come from? And that term is very much a misnomer. There's absolutely nothing in the law whatsoever about not asking anybody. The only time it comes up is at the very end of the law, and I encourage you all to read it. It's about 4 pages long, half of which is why gay people are bad, and then the other half is how we're going to implement the law. And at the very end of the law, it basically says it's the sense of Congress that the military should stop asking people if they're gay when they're joining the military. And by and large, the military doesn't do that anymore. They used to do it under the old regulatory ban. They don't do that under the current law. But as I tell people, people are, in fact, service members are asked every single day. It's questions like, what'd you do last weekend? You're new to town. Who are you living with? Where do you live? Where are you going for Thanksgiving? You know, you're a great guy. Do you want to be set up with my sister? She's single, too. All sorts of questions like that. And I have a million anecdotal stories about people just trying to survive in the military and trying to get to know their coworkers, but at the same time having to put up this huge shield and lying each and every day about who they are, who they live with, the fundamental parts of who they are. And one quick story to illustrate that is the story of Jenny Kopstein, who actually testified in the log cabin trial. She's testified before the Senate Armed Services Committee. And she talks about how, as a physics major at the Naval Academy, she never had to tell anything about her personal life to anybody. Once she graduates, she's at her first duty assignment, and people are asking these questions. The questions normal people ask each other when they get to know each other. I mean, think of what you asked your classmates here. And she said she decided she was never going to lie again, ultimately voluntarily came out. And after that time, she said such a huge burden was lifted because she could finally be honest with her coworkers. She could establish relationships with them, get to know them better, and build trust, which is obviously very key in the military. Quickly on don't tell, that's really the most unforgiving portion of all, because as I said, it means don't tell anyone, anytime, ever. And there are no exceptions for what would be inhumane or cruel or whatnot. So to quickly illustrate that, I had a client who came out in his suicide note, said he was struggling with his sexual orientation. That was part of the reason he attempted suicide. He called up our office shortly after he was actually in the hospital at the time and was concerned because he knew the military was going to see his suicide note when they went to collect his belongings. That's legitimate under don't ask, don't tell. So there aren't any exceptions for that's, you know, really cruel to use this information. If you've told anyone ever, it can be used against you.
Great, thank you very much. So Clark, so I'm gonna give you a softball and I'm gonna press you a little bit harder. So, you know, the log cabin Republicans have been actually mounting a kind of three-front war, if you will. So the most prominent is obviously the case that you've won in the judiciary, but you also do a lot of lobbying in the executive and legislative branches. But if you could just tell us a little bit about the case itself and this major victory that you won last month and then more recently with respect to the injunction, that would be helpful. And then I'll follow up.
Sure. Well, for starters, I don't know where people have, what they are aware about the case. I'll start with it. The case was filed in 2004. This is not a recent case. The trial, it went to trial as recently as July as this year. So back in 2004, when this went to trial, many of the folks who were involved in it now weren't even the full-time national staff, including myself, or elsewhere, either in school. I was serving in the Bush administration at the time, also was an early reservist. I was actually, when it was filed, I was actually in combat against the Mahdi Army. I do remember when it was filed. Fast forward to 2010, we finally get a trial date in July in the Ninth Circuit in California, in Riverside, California. We make a facial challenge, which is very difficult, challenge the constitutionality or lack thereof of the Don't Ask, Don't Tell statute, say that it's a violation of First and Second Amendment rights, it violates free speech, it violates due process, make our case, get our ruling, and then move forward to where we have an injunction in place, and then DOJ came back and requested a stay, and Judge Phillips said, you've had plenty of time to make your case, you've not made it, and of course, no surprise, we're planning for a lengthy appeals process. It could go to the Supreme Court. Personally, I'd rather it not for several reasons. The first one being, this arcane policy is already going on 17 years. I would hate to see this drug out any further. And then there's also the other aspect of just the cost and dragging it through courts. Plus, it could become moot in a lame duck session. There is the legislative process. These are not mutually exclusive. A log cabin has been working on a three-theater front or a three-pronged approach to this. We have been strongly advocating for repeal in Congress. It was born in Congress. It should die there. As Richard mentioned, this is the only time you're going to hear me defend President Obama, so listen closely. No president could, by fiat, do what Harry Truman did in 1948 and issue an executive order and make this go away because it is statute. And that was a challenge that actually was looked at internally during the Bush administration when the transition between Rumsfeld to Secretary Gates. We had gotten to the point, I do recall internally, that because of our campaigns in Afghanistan and Iraq and our peacekeeping operation commitments through the UN Security Council, which remain a burden on our country, were a burden then. Dick Cheney referred to this as the old chestnut, you know, that we need to take care of and get rid of. So this has been a burden across the party lines when, as far as governance and administration is concerned, of our defense assets. So here we are, and unfortunately, Bush nor Obama could just do what Truman did in 1948, and it does need to either die by being struck from code, struck from statute, or as what we're having now, we have what I call a temporary fix, which is this injunction status. This can't go on forever. So this is the terrain we're at now. The other thing that was mentioned was the executive process. There is a comprehensive review that is due by order of Secretary Gates of December 1 of this year. I personally, not only as the head of the organization, the plaintiff organization, but as a service member, am very much looking forward to this review because I participated in that survey process. There's been some criticism within different organizations and with the LGBT community about how it was done. But remember, the guidances that were given is that the audience that they're doing is the defense audience, defense service members, defense family members, not just advocates and campaigners for repeal. So I think from where I see it, the terms of reference that were put out there are relatively fair. One of the things that Richard kind of alluded to in, at the time, former Secretary Powell, then Chairman of Joint Chiefs of Staff, was Richard was referring to the UCMJ, the Uniform Code of Military Justice. And one of the points that we have made at Log Cabin when meeting with Republican members of Congress, because that's who I meet, I don't have to meet with anybody except our side of the aisle, and with the defense civil servants as well as Gates' study group, has been to focus on the UCMJ. And that there's no need to change it. And I'm happy to say that many of these civil servant attorneys, the folks that are doing what Aaron used to do for DOD, actually concur that regardless if don't ask, don't tell goes away through a judicial process or through a legislative process, there's no need to change the Uniform Code of Military Justice because fraternization is fraternization. It doesn't matter if it's between a male colonel and a female sergeant or a male colonel and a male sergeant. Whatever is a no-go. Violations of the Hatch Act doesn't matter. You can't wear a Bush-Cheney button in uniform. You can't wear an Obama-Biden button on your uniform. And these are kind of the things that I think were initially envisioned when Don't Ask, Don't Tell was being created back in 1992, 1993, was that people can have personal expression, but when in uniform, you follow orders and you're in compliance with UCMJ. It's part of the reason why I've been asked by media sources and folks in academia, well, we never see you in uniform again. I'm gonna be in compliance with the UCMJ. I will violate, and I've been violating Don't Ask, Don't Tell since I took my commission, but I won't violate UCMJ. I equate it to a member of Congress who, you know, Senator Scott Brown, he, like me, puts on a uniform once a month. Congressman Charles DeJoux, who, by the way, we endorsed for re-election this cycle, from Hawaii, who is pro-repeal and actually was a co-sponsor on the House repeal legislation. He, like myself, is an Army Reserve captain, but you don't ever see Congressman DeJoux talk about policy and politics when he's in uniform because that is not in compliance with the UCMJ. So those are some points that I would like to tie around the case and that it's not just a myopic approach because it would actually probably be a very weak strategy. And so I will make an analogy to military planning and operations is that when preparing for battle and doing war gaming, we, the United States, do a very good job at looking at multiple enemy courses of action as well as friendly courses of action and looking at capabilities that are out there. And so in planning, once we went at a trial date in July, we were looking at the legislative calendar, we were looking at the executive calendar, and we were taking that all into play. And so while it is very exciting right now that we have had a week, essentially, a little over a week of non-enforcement of the Don't Ask, Don't Tell statute, and we've had a few days of open recruitment, This is nowhere near over. So far, so good, though.
Okay. Thank you. So to push you a little bit, given that I pushed Richard, I feel like it's only right that I put some pressure on you, too. So the kind of solution that you want is a legislative solution, Clark, right? But in this election, I assume
that's ideal.
That you want Republicans to make gains in
sure.
the Senate, right? Which would make it very difficult, even more difficult than it is now. And if we look at the recent filibuster, the break was just startling to me. So on the one hand, I want to just embrace
sure.
the fact that there's a kind of beautiful Nixon goes to China kind of dimension to your form of argumentation, right? Which is to say that you can make arguments that I can't, you know, as a progressive Democrat, because people are going to listen to you because you're a voice inside of the party. So I want to celebrate that and say this is a bipartisan effort. This is great. On the other hand, when I look at your side of the aisle in the Senate, I see 56-43 vote with all 40 Republican senators voting. Mm-hmm. You know, to filibuster after this has gone through the House. So we could have ended this policy if Republicans were more sympathetic.
And if Harry Reid let us have some amendments, so let's start talking about that.
Right. Yeah. On procedural grounds,
okay,
yeah. But, I mean, if we actually look at that and you say, okay, well, maybe, you know, after we get past the election, you know, people actually go back to their principles and not, you know, care about this so much. But that's a very small window before the new Senate comes in, right?
Right.
So help me with that.
Sure.
You know, like I'm sort of caught between this
yeah.
idea of wanting to celebrate this, but also saying, why are you trying to persuade people who seem to be so unbelievably obstinate on this issue?
Well, if any of you have done any lobbying or any advocacy, and many of you probably have prior to coming to law school, and some of you may do this when you get out, is to never abdicate terrain. And one of the lessons learned, I think, from the broader community standpoint, from the LGBT community, is to not be politically myopic, because bipartisan votes are how any kind of legislation succeeds. Yes, having a majority is great. I know what it's like to be in the majority. But at the end of the day, even during the Bush administration, President Bush needed Democrats to cross the aisle to succeed. President Obama needs Republicans to cross the aisle to succeed. So that's kind of a no-brainer, but it's one that we have to remind ourselves all the time. It's one that I have to remind fellow advocates within the gay community, is that, you know, if you think that I'm the skunk at the picnic, you need me more than you maybe really do realize. Now, going back to the technical point regarding the vote that took place, there was not a vote on Don't Ask, Don't Tell this year. There was a vote, a procedural vote, to move toward debate, to actually start debating the broader defense authorization bill for 2011. And I'll explain it this way. There are many issues that were put into that larger package, the annual defense authorization bill. Obviously, from my perspective and from many of us here today, we were focused on the portion about the debate on repeal of Don't Ask, Don't Tell. If you were in the immigration reform community, there are people who are focused on the DREAM Act, which was also incorporated into the defense authorization bill. Why I mention that is because if one looks at all the reporting and the talk at the time leading up to that vote, it was, this is the vote on Don't Ask, Don't Tell. And if you're in the immigration reform committee community, it was, this is the vote on the DREAM Act. But it wasn't. It was actually a vote to move forward on debate on the bill, which would have then incorporated all of those pieces. Where there was a train wreck between the parties, between the majority leader and the minority leader, was that Harry Reid at the time, at the beginning, said, I have this metaphorical amendment tree. Here's what I've placed in it. This is all we're doing. We're not doing anything else. And senators who were sympathetic to seeing the Don't Ask, Don't Tell debate take place before they adjourn for the election season said, look, and I'm paraphrasing, look, Harry, can you just throw us a bone here? Can you give us a few amendments? Because then that opens it up, and we can address some things. And mind you, this is the defense authorization bill, so it is rife with every kind of imaginable piece of pork and parochial interest on BRAC, you know, base realignment, particular assets that might be built or contracted in a particular district or state. So, again, looking at it from a macro viewpoint, there were a lot of other moving pieces and still remain a lot of moving pieces in that defense bill. In fact, there was one piece of that defense bill where President Obama said, if the Joint Striker Alternative Engine is in this bill, I'm going to veto it. So we had a veto threat from the president. We still have a veto threat from the president on the defense bill. Anyway, Senator Reid said, absolutely not. I'm not going to give the Republicans an inch. You're not going to get an amendment. You're not even going to get a half an amendment. Well, what happened was, is any of those Republicans that were sympathetic toward a absolute yes vote on repeal actually closed ranks and said, game over. You're not playing fair here. So, you know, either give us an amendment or two or a slot and we'll move forward, or we don't move forward. So there's the Paul Harvey backstory to that. So, of course, what the news was that Republicans voted against either the DREAM Act or voted against Don't Ask, Don't Tell. What they voted against was to proceed with, there was a vote against cloture to proceed with debate on the bill. Now, fast forward to this lame duck session that they're going to have when they get back after the elections. We do have enough votes right now. We do believe that in the next Congress in 2011, there's enough votes there. I would like to have more, but it's interesting. You meant the calendar has, in a weird way, been an assist on several things. Having the House vote take place first, I think, helped engender some courage with some senators. Our litigation actually has been helpful. I was concerned about that. I thought it might, from a conservative viewpoint, activist judges are seen as a problem. And frankly, some of our supporters in Log Cabin, elected Republicans, have had mixed feelings about this ruling. You know, they're happy that it's attacking the statute, but they also are having a little heartburn that it's coming from the court and not the Congress. So, needless to say, there's been some movement to give some help. And again, past November 2nd, some parochial political issues disappear, and some members, we may get some additional votes. But safe to say, right now, today, in October, before election, we have the votes in the Senate. We should have the same votes, if not additional votes, after November 2nd.
Great. With that, I'd like to open this up to the floor. So,
before you start, can I just do
of course, just, it's actually just, perfect, because if you will raise your hand, a mic will come to you while Richard is commenting.
So let me just say that some of that I thought was really stretching it. I mean, the Democrats in Congress and our Democratic president have certainly not met our expectations over the course of the last 2 years in this regard. There are no profiles in courage there, save perhaps maybe some of the work that Nancy Pelosi and Carl Levin and Kirsten Gillibrand did. But to suggest for a second that Republicans would have voted for this but for the fact that they were treated unfairly for Harry Reid is ridiculous. I mean, it's just a ridiculous assertion. It's not true.
We're talking about a cloture vote.
Yeah, the Republicans opposed this because the Republicans didn't want gay people to serve in the military. Now, you guys have done a fantastic job in this court case. You're to be commended. I love that there are Log Cabin Republicans. I love that there's an organization devoted to this. When I was in the White House, I always worked with this organization because I think it was important and an important force in our fight for equality. But you, as good a job as you have done on this case, you've done a horrible job lobbying Republican members of Congress, because virtually, that you know, you could count on one hand the number of Republican senators who support that and they support us on this, and they all defected because they were so spineless that they couldn't stand up to their leadership and vote for equality, and they put up these, you know, they put up this notion that they weren't voting for it because it was unfair and it was procedural, whatever. So, I mean, we'll have an argument.
They're still voting for repeal.
Right. Okay. Yeah. But they're not.
Maybe we'll pause.
We'll get into. But
they told me they're voting for repeal,
and
Richard.
And let me just also just say.
Do they
one
talk
little,
to you?
One little asterisk on your. Some of them talk to me. One little asterisk on your point about that the only way to get through this, to get beyond this, is legislative. That, in other words, that this is now a legislative pronouncement. You have to, in order to end Don't Ask, Don't Tell, we have to have an act of Congress and a new law signed by the president. That is true, but but I think it's now undisputed that there have always been administrative avenues available to the president, whoever that president is, to put a moratorium, a complete and total moratorium, on discharges under this law. There are several avenues available. We can explore them if you want. They're available to the president. They're available to the Secretary of Defense. So yes, it's true. In order to repeal this law, obviously we're all lawyers or law students, in order to repeal a law, you have to have an act of Congress, another act of Congress. But you can stop dead in its tracks enforcement of this law by either the Secretary of Defense issuing new regulations or the president, or the president issuing an executive order.
Right. Great. Clark, I think you deserve a right of response there.
Sure.
I'll start with, I think we've done a damn good job on getting votes. You're right, Richard. We only can count on one hand. I only can count five senators right now that would vote. I only could count about 12 on the House side. Now, I will say, and this is what I say to folks in the LGBT community, if we weren't there, if I wasn't there, there's nobody else there. And I say I'm referring to my team as well. The log cabin wasn't there. There were many times when we would go into House and Senate offices. And mind you, my first day on the job was May 25th, which is a really shotgun start. That's when the Senate Armed Services Committee was taking this up. And we were going into House and Senate offices where members and staff themselves said, you're the first people to come talk to us about repeal. You're the first people who are in support of repeal to come to my office and make a case. So, doesn't mean that we converted everybody each time, but I found that as an astounding lesson in that, again, going back to the why we need to be bipartisan in our work, is that abdicating terrain almost guarantees a loss, right? I mean, you look at sales, if someone says, well, or in fundraising, I don't want to call them, I don't want to knock on their door, they're probably going to say no. Well, if you don't knock on their door and you don't call them, then the answer is no. So obviously there's a lot of work to be done. I wish we had more votes in the Senate and the House, but I can tell you that I know for now, I know for certain there are a number of votes that we do have that had we not been present, they would not have been there because other organizations weren't knocking on those doors, we're not calling those members, and we're not contacting those staff.
Floor? Yes, in the back. Actually, if you could speak in the mic because
it's a fascinating conversation, but there's a word I'm hardly hearing, which is war.
I'm sorry. I should say before anyone asks a question that all of your questions are being recorded. So if you do not want to be recorded, please don't ask a question.
And tell us, give us your name.
I'm Bill Dobbs, and I'm fascinated by the conversation, but there's a word I'm hardly hearing, war. What about the matter of two wars we're waging, and at least an occupation or two, against equality? Many people, I'm sure, here and elsewhere want to get rid of discrimination, but what troubles me is that that push is done in such a way as to have the myopia that was referenced, and says nothing, and it's all about a workplace issue, but says nothing about our foreign policy. And these are not separate issues, because one of the takeaway from all these campaigns is that it's great to join the military, that war is good. And some of that message will eradicate a lot of organizing and thinking about what it is to be in the world's lone superpower. And a little asterisk for Mr. Socarides, which is, you wrote the talking points, did you not, for President Clinton while you were in his office? Some would say that would have been a time to resign.
Okay, so let me just address those two things quickly.
Okay, and then we'll go to Aaron.
You are absolutely right that one of the jobs, when you sign up to work at the White House, your first job every day is to try to make the president look good. Part of that is sometimes helping him describe in the best communications way you know how a policy that you may disagree with. So, you know, that does happen, and to that I plead guilty. I think that Bill raises a very interesting question about, you know, why are we so focused on earning the right to wage military combat. And I think that there, you know, however you feel about war and however you feel about the wars we're in, and I certainly have strong feelings about it myself, I think that, you know, all these things are symbols of equality, and that's why they're important, even on something like the marriage debate, which is going on. I mean, you know, it's not really so much about whether it's marriage or civil unions. These are proxy issues, and they're proxy issues for whether or not you believe in full and complete equality without exception, whether or not you believe in full equality now. And if you stand on, you know, if you stand up for full equality and total equality in everything right away, marriage, the right to fight in the military, these are all issues that have enormous symbolism with them. And when much like we did in the racial civil rights struggle, when we won the right to interracial marriage, you know, all the other stuff fell by the wayside, or it was the beginning of the falling by the wayside.
Eric?
And the thing I would like to point out, I mean, we go to gay pride festivals, we do a lot of outreach to people all across the country, and we do get the questions about the war. As an organization, we don't take an opinion on that, because at the end of the day, kind of to echo Richard, the idea for us is that being able to serve in the military is a fundamental part of what it means to be a citizen in this country. Whether or not you choose to do that or not, whether or not you agree with the wars that are going on or not, for a lot of people, that's a very important thing to be able to do. It's from a deep sense of patriotism. For a lot of the folks we speak to, at the end of the day, they want to join the military for the very same reasons everybody else wants to join. It's not necessarily to go off to war, but it's more practical considerations. So I'll put patriotism on the side, but think about the GI Bill. For a lot of people, that's the only way they're ever going to be able to afford to go to college. For a lot of other people we speak to, it's their way to get out of the small town where they live. And you think for a lot of LGBT teenagers growing up in these small towns across the country, and we've heard about the epidemic of suicides, things along those lines, for them, this is really one of the few escapes that they have. It's one of the few places that will accept them. And I remember, I mean, some of the saddest cases I've had are people who are 18 years old, they've joined the military, and maybe after 6 months, after maybe a year, they're kicked out and put onto the street. And then I remember speaking to one of these guys, he was serving out at Fort Lewis in Washington. They stuck him on a Greyhound bus, and he's gonna have to go home and live with his parents, who are not accepting of gay people. He had never been out to them before, ever in his life. And he had to explain to them why he just got fired from his job for being gay, and this is gonna be the first time he had to come out to them. So for a lot of the people we speak to, this is kind of their way up and out of where they are in their life, and it's a very important thing to be able to do. In addition to that, you know, another way to think about this is we want there to be advances in all segments of the LGBT world in terms of civil rights. You think about marriage, we think about ENDA, all these sorts of things. And to me, it's in a way difficult to argue for all this other progress when we still have a law on the books that requires people, like absolutely requires people to be fired for being gay. So it's hard to argue that we want other rights in these other areas when you have this law that the federal government is requiring you to be fired. So I think in terms of making progress in other areas as well, it's important that we get rid of this law that's out there.
Do you want to jump in, Clark?
Sure. Okay. Yeah. I've never been asked that question, because remember, we're a Republican organization, so we're pro-defense. and actually, that's part of the case we do make, is that because there is a Venn diagram with the gay auxiliary of the party, and that obviously, and I won't bore you with that list, but one of them is a strong national defense. And so, of course, when I'm meeting with members of Congress and Republican policymakers, I said, look, we're with you on having a strong national defense, and to make it ensure that is that open service needs to be available for all those who are fit for duty, regardless of their orientation. Nixon to China was mentioned earlier. I have to admit, I come from the Henry Kissinger School of realpolitik, so why do we need a strong military in 2010? Well, let's see. Let's go back to 1989. There's no bipolarity in the world right now, good or bad. And by default, the United States did become, and we still are. There are some challenges and incursions on that, but we are the current superpower. We are the number one contributor to peacekeeping operations that are mandated by the UN just down the street, north of here over on First Avenue. We are the lead on PKOs, on peacekeeping operations. There is nobody else at this time right now. We have allies who don't have the full capabilities and capacities that we have, but the burden, that mantle, is on us. It is on us. We are carrying the torch for civil society, and we are carrying the torch for rule of law, like it or not. This wasn't by design. Part of it was by design post-1945 with the Marshall Plan, but again, 1989 actually changed, was a more of a game changer, really, than 2011, than 9/11 was for us as far as foreign policy is concerned. So as long as we have this role, the military will be part of that instrument for us abroad. And so that's a personal perspective. I'm giving you a very partisan viewpoint as to why it's important. But to tie back to what Richard and Aaron had said, no one should be denied the right to conduct service or for patriotic reasons or for foreign policy reasons or for just for the sheer fact that they want to get out of Dodge and get away from mom and dad. But going back to the foreign policy question, right now our military is a tool. It is an instrument. We are much sought after and much dependent on outside our borders. I would gander, just as a quick exercise, is anybody here aware, and be honest, I mean, if you do know, you get a gold star. Did you know that we have troops in Kenya? We do. We do. Actually, we have more than that, but you're close.
Defending and protecting us? What are we doing in Iraq and Afghanistan? What's the ethics and the morality of that compared to your quest for equality?
Okay, I'm going to use my moderator's prerogative and move to the next question, and you should feel free to take up any follow-ups with the panelists afterwards. So if we could move to this side of the room, the woman in the back.
Hi, my name is Sarah. There was a news piece about the possibility of segregated barracks if this decision is upheld, and I was wondering if you could speak to the log cabin position on that.
That's absolutely silly. good question, but in funny you should, and I'm glad you asked that because that's the dialogue that's actually occurring at the line level or at the troop level. When the injunction came out on the 12th, I happened to be on active duty, just random chance. I was out at Fort Huachuca, Arizona. The news didn't get out really till the 13th because of the time difference. And frankly, when you're doing war gaming, and you're not really focused on what's happening in the news. But some of that was talked about, and I haven't heard any compelling interest or case for that inside the military. Again, granted, most of the people I'm in my 30s. Most of the people I work with are in their 30s and 20s or younger. That has not been a real focus. The folks who I've heard talk about segregated barracks are people like Elaine Donnelly, who's never served in the military and is kind of kooky, and maybe some older folks. And not to knock the older generation, but when you get into the baby boomers and older, that's where some of those questions start to arise. But when you get to Gen X and lower, it's less of an issue. So.
And the quick thing I would say there is the facts on the ground already speak to that issue. I mean, just to kind of flesh it out, I have a client who was kicked out under Don't Ask, Don't Tell, became a contractor, is now living basically in the very same barracks he was living in beforehand. He's completely out to absolutely everybody he works with, getting paid a hell of a lot more, but completely out to all of them. It's not an issue, and I think that happens every day. In addition to that, we're serving with foreign militaries. We're housed in similar or the same facilities with them. Again, not an issue. So the facts on the ground basically belie any argument you'd make for segregated barracks.
Right. As Aaron said, there was and is joint billeting right now, or lodging, with our allies, like the UK and like Australia and Canada, in Iraq, in Afghanistan. Not an issue. So,
okay. Adrian?
Sticking with the need for the legislative solution and really just the numbers to get to that, kind of on the political side, while you're engaged in all this lobbying, why is log cabin Republicans continuing to endorse candidates that are less in favor of the Don't Ask, Don't Tell repeal, such as those who are running against
We only endorse candidates that support repeal.
Oh, but the Don't Ask, Don't Tell sponsor, Patrick Murphy, and his opponent, Fitzgerald, who has come out against the legislation. and said that
Fitzgerald's supportive of repeal. His Republican, you're talking about the former member in District 8 in Pennsylvania, is actually for repeal. He's also for employment non-discrimination legislation as well.
And has spoken very negatively about the legislation, though.
The process. But he's actually on record for repeal. Or else we would...
He's just one of those people who would vote for it if it came up in just the right way.
to go back to the broader point of the question, we did just... Log Cabin Republicans this week rolled out a second endorsement list, and we did a first endorsement list. What's unique about... What's the big deal about endorsements? What is different from the past is my predecessors couldn't give endorsements away when back during the 1990s, right, during the Clinton administration. Richard probably remembers this. In 1996, a check was given back by the Dole campaign to Log Cabin Republicans. Things have changed so much in a positive direction that I don't have that problem, because my position is you need to work for your endorsement, and you need to prove why we want to give you money. And they're asking us for endorsements and money. There are two races in New York where they came back. The RNC came back and said, hey, could you all do TV ads for Richard Hanna and Nan Hayworth in New York? Because if the New Yorkers know that Log Cabin endorses them, it's going to help them win. Wow.
Can I just say that I think that the shocking thing about the legislative process this year was how how behind the times the Congress appears to be relative to where we've come culturally.
I concur
because
with that.
This is repeal of this law in some of the polling is supported by almost 80% of the public. So this is not, one of those areas where we're sort of at a 50-50 point. This is not, and there are some rights areas like that. This is, if the legislative process reflected the public opinion, you would be able to pass a repeal of Don't Ask, Don't Tell with something like 80% of the members of Congress. But the fact is that we have a president who decided early on that he would defer to the Pentagon on a timetable for this, and I think he made that strategic decision very early on. And I happen to think it was a miscalculation. But there are some people who still believe that that was a smart decision, and that it will down the road we'll appreciate it. It reflects the fact that no one of either party, with the possible exception of Kirsten Gillibrand in New York, Nancy Pelosi from California, and Carl Levin, were willing to stand up to the president and say, we're not willing to wait for this. And that you also had, I think, we have a system in Washington where the gay groups that lobby on our behalf on equal rights issues are very plugged in to the Democratic Party. And I think that the gay groups early on, I'm not including Aaron's group, in this discussion, the general gay rights groups very early on bought into the White House's timetable on this. So no one was pushing the Congress to do this faster. And my own personal view is that the only way this is going to happen is if we all push on all fronts. We've got to have these cases move forward in the courts. We've got to have all of our groups in Washington pushing members of Congress. So we've got to push in the courts, and we've got to press the president. And that's what I and some others have been trying to do. I'll stop there.
So there's an interesting data point that backs up what Richard said, that Aaron and I found out with other folks, because just... So you all know, on the lobbying, we do exchange notes. There's kind of the interagency equivalent of doing remains of the day on lobbying efforts. But back to the huge delta or divide between public opinion and Congress, one of the interesting things that, sad, but interesting data points that Log Cabin staffers found, at least on our side of the aisle, was that the huge divide, and again, it goes back to the generational divide of member and staff. I'm not kidding you when I tell you that 99% of the MLAs, which is a military legislative assistant, and some of these are prior service, some are attorneys, some are not, but they are the They are the staff in charge of working defense authorization and defense appropriation issues for their senators or House members. 99% of those Republican staffers are pro-repeal. That does not match up with the number of Republicans that have either not taken a position on repeal or have said, well, we're going to wait for DOD to get their study done. And that was astounding for us from a learning perspective to find that we had these MLAs that would say, hey, man, I'm with you, but my boss here, or you know, he or she, help me help you. That was a huge teaching point for us, actually.
Okay. We have 20 minutes left. I see a forest of hands, so I'd ask both the questions and the answers to be as parsimonious as possible so we can get as many as we can get in. So, yes, the gentleman in the back. Yes. The mic's behind you.
Sorry. Okay, I'm going to have to... I wrote a lot of notes, so I'm going to have to trim this down a little bit. I'll go with this one. This is to Mr. Cooper. You mentioned regarding the stop loss, the executive order that President Obama can't do to repeal the law. We understand that, and I think Mr. Socarides talked to that. There was a study that was, actually several studies that were done in 2009 and 2010 that said that the president could, at the very least, cease or stop loss the soldiers that were being expelled while simultaneously pushing for repeal through the Congress. I just want to know why you think that was not done, why President Obama didn't show that kind of leadership in doing this, and why so much of the repeal process was really pushed onto the military, when the military, maybe because of the general audience or because of the groupthink, I think that's found in many of the older members of the military, would be extremely conservative. I'm sure if you did a survey of military leaders in the 1940s, they'd say no blacks in the military. And so, you know, this whole idea of a survey to the troops and a survey of the generals and so forth and so on seems to be a bit counterproductive. So I just wanted to get your thoughts on that.
Well, for the first one, I can't answer to what President Obama has. I mean, I served in the previous administration, so I don't know where he was coming from. But as far as the survey, I took place in there was two surveys. There was one where you would get randomly selected, and it would be Sergeant Smith, Captain Jones, you're going to take the survey. There was another one where service members could actually write in to a drop box. That survey was important, I thought, from a positive perspective, because as you mentioned, or you referred to the personnel, the service branches, there's a personnel pyramid at DOD. And the base of the pyramid is the majority of your personnel. Those are folks that are ranged, they're the youngest. They're ones that care the least. You want those surveys captured because they will outweigh the top of the pyramid, which is the smallest amount, which is your Gen X and higher, your long length of your career, higher ranking officers. So I thought it was very important that the 19-year-old private voice was captured, because if it wasn't captured, then we would just be holding to opinions by general officers who were from the Vietnam era.
Right. So. One quick point on the working group study that's expected to come out by December 1st is we've been in contact with them, and DOD has been adamant that at the end of the day, all these quote-unquote surveys that went out are in fact really not surveys. It's just trying to get a feeling from the troops about what implementation of repeal is going to be about and what kind of hurdles they're going to have to overcome. So at the end of the day, we hope there should not ever be anything that says 80% think this or 60-something percent think that. It should just allow them to have a feeling for what the issues might be.
Great. Other questions? Yes.
Shifting to effectiveness away from don't ask, don't tell, is there, the gay rights group has not been very effective with people in the middle. And Log Cabin's done a lot of work, for example, on renewal of Ryan White Act here in Albany on marriage. And one thing that struck me a lot is that a lot of people in the middle who are willing to support gay causes are so just vehemently dislike the gay rights groups. I remember meeting with Frist, and he was very good on reauthorizing Ryan White, but he was just very you know, frustrated with HRC. Here in Albany, we could have gotten civil rights through the Senate, but ESPA said marriage or nothing. So is this absolutist and partisan attitude by the gay rights group, which is very, very understandable, does it undermine the effectiveness of getting things done?
Well, that's an interesting question. I think it really depends upon your perspective. What you consider the kind of what you call the absolutism of the gay rights groups conveys, the notion that they're sort of being very tough with people, all or nothing. But I think a lot of other people would think that generally speaking, they're not tough enough. So it really depends from your perspective, what perspective you come at it on. But what the issue that I do think that your question touches on, and which is kind of the way the panel is formed, is this notion that now, for the first time in the history of our movement, we have people who are considered very substantial political players on the right, who have come forward and urged that gay people ought to have equal rights. I'm thinking of Ken Mellman, who's the former head of the Republican Party and the former White House political director, who recently came out as gay, and especially Ted Olson, who is he was the Solicitor General, a Republican Solicitor General. There is probably no one in the Republican conservative legal community who, before he took on the Prop 8 case, was more respected than Ted Olson. And I think both of these people, especially in Ted Olson's case, because he is probably not the best lawyer for this case, but the best lawyer, maybe the best lawyer for any case in the Supreme Court, just because he knows, he not only is he technically an excellent lawyer, but and has argued perhaps more Supreme Court cases as Solicitor General than almost anybody, but he knows the judges personally on the Republican side. I mean, so he knows where to come at them. So to have a guy like Ted Olson fighting for us and fighting this, I mean, the brilliance of this Perry versus Schwarzenegger case there's a lot of brilliance in that case, but the real brilliance was the idea that this guy Chad Griffin had. Who put this together, who's a PR guy out in California, who said, we ought to get the best conservative lawyer money can buy and the best Democratic progressive lawyer money can buy and put them together and get them to bring this case. I mean, that is really what is going to, make that case so important for us.
Great. Next question. Okay. Yes?
Yeah. All right. David, to go off of that, to what extent, if any, did the sort of Perry v. Schwarzenegger people talk with you either about legal strategy coordination or even PR strategy coordination? Because I know that you guys started your case far before they did, and their case seemed to be much more publicized. And so I was just wondering, either on legal grounds or sort of PR grounds, what communication there was between the two of you.
Sure. Actually, there was some dialogue with AFER. This is Americans for Equal Rights. They're the ones that actually were the lead on Perry v. Schwarzenegger. There was some dialogue about that. There are multiple theories as to the challenge with the media coverage. I know that from a staff perspective, some media outlets, I won't name them, almost reacted to the fact that we were taking this lead on this on repeal of Don't Ask, Don't Tell, as it was a headline from The Onion. So that was part of the challenge in that it seemed as though it was anathema to who we were. And so we had to, that was an information operation hurdle we had to get over internally. I think we were over it now. Not anybody at this table, but there were some challenges inside the community as far as recognizing that this was our case. We have them, but we took some screenshots when the full ruling came down this summer. Many organizations talked about the ruling, did not cite the plaintiff.
in the community, and that was very disappointing. I had to make a lot of phone calls that day.
Great. Hi, my name is Greg. How much planning is being done for what comes next? I mean, I know you want to focus on the task at hand and winning a final victory for repeal, but implementation of it is going to be a difficult issue. It's not just the bell's going to ring and people are going to come out and nobody's going to care. So how much are you trying to, specifically talking to you, Mr. Tax, how much is your group trying to shape the implementation of the rules once repeal occurs, and just what are your thoughts for what the environment's going to be then?
We've spent a lot of time thinking about this, and we've submitted papers to the working group who's doing the study about what we think should happen. But at the end of the day, we don't think it should be very complicated. There are issues, and I think this is kind of the MO of our opponents, which is to say this is so complicated. Clark Cooper referenced Elaine Donnelly, who runs this organization, Center for Military Readiness. She's also against women serving in the military, so I think it gives you an idea of who she is. And she had a press conference at the CPAC convention in DC earlier, I guess maybe it was late last year, where she has these like crazy flow charts. And if you go to her website, you'll see them. I mean, they're just kind of like, looks like pasta. I mean, it's like stuff going in every direction. And she's trying to say like how complicated this is going to be. And at the end of the day, it really isn't complicated. I mean, a few rules will have to be tweaked. But at the end of the day, all we're going to do is not fire people for being gay. And I think that's something that we've all talked about with the injunction. That's, you know, people are saying, oh my God, it's going to be the end of the world. And Secretary Gates is saying it's had enormous consequences. Check out enormousconsequences.com, run by the Palm Center. And I mean, it's kind of entertaining. Nothing's really happened. I mean, you've had an injunction now for so many days. It's been a non-issue.
It's been a big shoulder shrug of big deal.
But in terms of planning, you know, there's a lot of questions about how to deal with people who want to get back in. And just to give you an example, right now, if you're kicked out under Don't Ask, Don't Tell, you get what's called an RE4 code. It's a lifetime ban on serving in the military in any capacity ever again. One question is that waivable? Is that something they can overlook? Who's going to decide that? Is there going to be a panel that you'd have to go to? Are you just going to walk down to your local recruiting station? Are they going to deal with you? So what are the mechanics of getting people back in? Another example, say you were kicked out after 15 years. You want to get your 5 more years towards retirement. But technically speaking, you're too old to join the military at this point. But you could be serving, but for having been kicked out under Don't Ask, Don't Tell. Will they let you back in? So there's a bunch of hurdles like that we need to figure out, and pieces like that we have to figure out how to kind of put together. But at the end of the day, it shouldn't be very complicated. I know, for example, they're looking at how medical care is going to have to change in the military with people being out. I mean, all, like, ridiculous questions. I mean, things aren't going to change tremendously. And I think it'll be a big kind of ho-hum at the end of the day.
Great.
Maybe one last question.
Sarah. Okay. Yes.
The mic is coming to you. While it is, let me just unpack Aaron's statement, which is to say that the enormousconsequences.com website is a reference, as many of you know, to Secretary Gates's comment on the day after Judge Phillips's ruling that there would be enormous consequences to enjoining the military from enforcing Don't Ask, Don't Tell. And so the Palm Center, which is a liberal kind of think tank on military issues, issued or created this website to talk about the consequences in the wake of her ruling. Okay.
We haven't yet talked about the fact that the proposed repeal, it does repeal the legislation as it currently stands, but pushes the final decision making off to the military leaders, who, as my understanding is, are split on the issue. So I thought it would be nice if we could discuss that a little bit.
Sure. I mean, I'm really glad you asked that, the point here is that the legislation that Congress is now considering, which was filibustered last month in a filibuster effort led by Senator McCain, but which the hope is will come up again in December after the election, but before the new Congress is in, merely, as I understand it, repeals the existing law. It does not put in its place a law that says you can't discriminate against gay people in military service. So there was a fairly substantial, I mean, it's a little bit in the weeds, right? But it got lost in some of the media attention. But there was a fairly substantial argument within the gay rights community, you know, as to whether or not that was acceptable. And I personally believe it is totally unacceptable that as we repeal this law, that we simply wipe it off the books. We need to replace it with a law that says the government can no longer, will no longer, should no longer discriminate against gay people in the military. But as part of this compromise, where I didn't really think there was any need for one, between the Pentagon and the White House and members of Congress to get this bill through, this compromise that was supposed to work that didn't actually even result in getting us any legislation through the Congress, they placed in the legislation a couple of conditions that the questioner referred to. And one of them is the sign-off by the Joint Chiefs of Staff, and I think even in some versions, the service chiefs, and I think it's quite troubling. I think what you have is a situation where even if this legislation does pass, that we could get, and the lawsuit somehow isn't successful or gets deferred or the injunction gets delayed, we could have a situation where a year from now we still could have don't ask, don't tell, in effect.
And just to clarify one thing, the legislation is written right now requires President Obama, Secretary Gates, and Admiral Mullen all kind of oddly on the same level. Obama, for some reason, in this bill is not above them in the pecking order. But they all need to agree that basically gay people won't be a problem. That's what they're going to certify after they get a chance to look at the study. There's no timeline by which they have to decide that, so that technically could carry on for a year. But once the three of them, not the service chiefs, just the three of them, make that determination, don't ask, don't tell will then go away 60 days after that. But you're correct, some of the service chiefs have expressed opposition. They officially don't have a say in that certification process.
Yeah. Great. We're going to wrap up, and one of the last things I have to do is to announce the next forum, which is actually very exciting. As you know, the forum rotates from topic to topic, so our next topic is going to be Congress revisits the Bush tax cuts, who should pay taxes and how much. Our panelists are Diane Rogers, who's the chief economist of the Concord Coalition, Dan Shaviro of this law school, Alan Viard, who's a resident scholar at AEI, the American Enterprise Institute, and it'll be moderated by Barry Friedman. So with that, I would like you to join me in thanking our three terrific panelists. I'd also like to thank Outlaw for pressing to make this event happen, and I think that, well...